that this Assembly calls on the Minister for Communities to bring forward a replacement to the housing selection scheme that ensures a fairer and more transparent system of assessing housing need.
I call Mr. Fran McCann to move the motion.
And I rise to speak about this motion, which highlights the serious difficulties around the housing selection scheme. This is an issue I've raised at many different forums and meetings over this past number of years. The most recent was with the Minister for Communities several months ago, and the Minister accepted there were concerns around the present system used by the Housing Executive to allocate and point those in social housing waiting lists. There's a need to move this forward, and I accept that the Minister is not long on the post and will need time to reflect on how to deal with this problem. But I also believe it is timely for this Assembly to debate the workings of this scheme. I believe we need to focus on making changes to the selection scheme, which takes into consideration its limitations when it comes to what is known as areas of high demand. Also, the allocation of points to a number of categories of people whose serious circumstances are not recognised under the present system. The motion in front of the Assembly today calls on the Minister for the Department of Communities to bring forward a replacement scheme to the housing selection scheme that ensures a fairer and more transparent scheme. I believe it is widely recognised that the present scheme has serious flaws and condemns people who live in areas of high demand, such as West Belfast, North Belfast and Derry, to lengthy stays on waiting lists before being moved to a home, although there are today other parts of the North where problems exist. I believe failure to grasp the nettle now will condemn applicants to lengthy stays in hostels and in overcrowded conditions, but the scheme has other deficiencies. For many declaring themselves as homeless, it is a very traumatic experience, which for many begins in a housing executive office, which in my experience is intimidating and lacks privacy, especially in the Belfast office, which needs to be observed to appreciate the seriousness of the first stages of declaring yourself as homeless. I have heard it described by those who have went through this process as a cattle market with little privacy. I have also heard from those who work in the executive that little training is available for those who work in the front desk on how they should speak to or inform people looking to be placed on the waiting list and pointed. This life-changing step for many and the journey from first contact through the selection scheme, gaining the right level of points and on to being allocated at home, impacts on parents and their children alike. I also understand that in the past years there have been a number of reviews of the housing selection scheme, but with little in the way of firm proposals. The more recent has been the pre-consultation review, which made suggestions around a system of bonding or choice-based lettings or a different way of allocating points. Many of these suggestions do not take in the reality of housing in the North and the difficulties which exist for housing providers and the people looking housed. I believe the Minister wants to move this forward, and in a way of advice, when looking at a way forward, there are a wide range of experts out there from the voluntary housing sector, housing executive, housing associations and your department who have pulled together could look at the present system and look at its flaws and see what can be made to work. Doing nothing is not an option. It is heartbreaking for a family to begin the journey of declaring yourself as homeless. When you declare yourself as being homeless and if you have dependent children, the housing executive have a responsibility to find you temporary accommodation, either in homeless hostels or a single let. You are then assessed and allocated a level of points which they say reflects your circumstances, such as 70 points for being homeless and an assortment of other points. Many of those who accept a place in a hostel at the declaration stage might go into that hostel with 120 or maybe 130 points, and at the end of 6 months get an additional 20 points reflecting the length of time spent in the hostel, which could bring you up to 150. But if you have indicated that your area of choice is in an area of high demand where you might need family support, you would need 180 to 200 points to be housed. Then you could sit for years in a hostel with little chance of being housed. The housing selection scheme does not take this into consideration. I have dealt with cases where people went into hostels when their child was born and their child had started primary school and had still had little chance of being housed. You have the most serious of situations where someone might be in a very abusive relationship and report that they are in constant danger of attack when declaring themselves as homeless, only to find that the selection scheme lets them down and will only award possibly an additional 20 points. The same goes for people who might be under threat in communities from antisocial elements or violent neighbours, and their lives might be in danger and are offered to take part in mediation with the very people who are intimidating them. Many leave their homes and head into the private rented sector after being awarded only 20 points, which does not reflect the seriousness of their circumstances. And yet you have a situation where someone might claim that they are under threat from a group, or they have been sent a bullet through the post, and after going to the police can't be awarded 200 points or more, and this puts you at the top of the waiting list. This can't be fair. Many believe these claims of intimidation are bogus. When the housing provider contacts the police, they confirm that they are investigating a threat to the lives of the applicant and they believe that person's lives are in danger. I've spoken to the PSNI, who have told me there's little in the way of investigation into these cases. This is obviously very frustrating to housing providers and those who know they are being cheated out of a home, because where they're sitting, they might be sitting at the top of the waiting list at that particular time. They know that many of these claims are bogus and used as a method of jumping housing waiting lists. I've recently asked the Minister to suspend the intimidation system until a proper way of verification can be established, not the flimsy procedure that exists at present. When you consider that a woman who feels under threat and individuals or families who are really living in fear, and then those who use intimidation as a method of jumping waiting lists, then I am not surprised most people feel they are dealing with a broken system. With more than 40,000 people on waiting lists, with close to 20,000 declaring themselves homeless every year, and whilst there is a terrible statistic, but there is also a hidden statistic, which those who apply for homeless status and refuse. Thousands of young people are turned away because they are young and are perceived to be healthy, and told the housing executive have no responsibility for their housing situation and won't point them. And are advised to go into the private rented sector, which has in itself many pitfalls for young vulnerable people. Being unregulated, with no system of tracking these young people, many end up lying on friends' floors or sofa surfing. I represent a constituency which has 4,077 people on the waiting list, 2,939 of them in housing stress, 1,203 of these are singles, 1,129 are classed as small families, 302 of them are older people, and 185 are large families, 88 of which are classified as large adults. And over the last year, there were 772 allocations, which in itself tells a story of lack of housing supply, and I suppose the bottom line in this is the need to build more houses, and when they are built, a system in place to ensure the fair and transparent selection scheme, which is about fairness. I would ask you to support this motion, and I would ask the Minister to take the lead in the discussion and making the changes required to ensure that this is put in place. Thank you very much.
Well, Mr. Jonathan Bell.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I think the whole House will endorse the import of the motion, which is that we take a fresh look and look towards a replacement to the housing selection scheme. And I welcome the fact, not only the Minister's here today, but I welcome the fact that both he and his department have stated that they are open and are currently engaged in looking at what we can do to ensure that the housing selection scheme that we come forward with is one that is fair, and I suppose more important than that, or as important as that, can be seen to be fair. Assessing housing need is incredibly complex. We all love to work on the basis that everybody that's bringing the information in front of us is honest, that the material we're dealing with can be equally weighed against each other, yet we have seen a trajectory from housing policy that started, it would seem, with, look, we will assess you from the time that you were first placed on the list, and that will be the criteria which we then use for all subsequent future allocations. right through to what I believe was a better attempt to try and distill down within those lists where there was urgency, where there was identified need, and to come up with a process that was fair to everybody involved and was also defensible. And I think a re-look, a fresh look at that, to see what we can contribute in terms of modernisation to ensure that fair, transferable knowledge and policy can be made, and I welcome the fact that the department is looking towards it. We've all faced the problem in our constituency offices with intimidation, but sure, some of the issues that the honourable member raised first, particularly around confidentiality when people are discussing their housing situations. I have been, and I'm sure I'm not unusual to any MLA in this house, in public bodies, in with the housing executive, where I have been waiting and not wanting to, but have been able to overhear people's conversations. And the nature of those conversations, people who are at their wits' end, are in many cases revealing very private details about their lives. And the particular case that I'm referring back to, it was domestic violence. And a very fair point has been made right at the very start of this debate that whatever we do, that in that assessment we should look at a more person-centred approach that would allow people the dignity, particularly when they are coming often. And we heard in earlier debates about the amount of hassle and abuse people undertake before they finally make the move. But when they've finally made the move, they're coming often at their wits' end. And there is a need for people to be treated with dignity and respect within that. We do have to look at the issue of intimidation. And I think we have to be honest that it does occur. And I think we equally have to be very sharp as to the fact that intimidation is not used inappropriately to move somebody ahead on a list where otherwise they couldn't be without, and this is the key part, without valid reason. We don't want to see the system being abused, and I think that we can reflect on the good practice we have. We've had two good reports with Northern Ireland and also looking at good practice in GB. And we should distill from those the important points to end up with a policy that reflects not only what has occurred in the past, but also the knowledge that we have gained within that. We also know the issues of homeless people that are making applications on the basis of unsuitable accommodation. And I would like the department to look very seriously at the issue of unsuitable accommodation. I should have declared at the start, it's on the register, a landlord myself, Mr. Speaker. But for people who are in the private sector, and I have visited homes that I and made referrals on to and advised people about the issue of environmental health in different departments within councils, where wallpaper is quite literally coming off the walls in the houses, where mould is growing right round the windows in the houses, and people who are extremely vulnerable
to conclude his remarks.
Are forced, Mr. Speaker, to make a decision. So a new policy, freshly looked at, Mr. Speaker, I think it's in the best interests of everyone in Northern Ireland.
Call Mr. Andy Allen.
Speaker, and I thank the member for bringing this very important motion before us today. And before I go into the basis of my comments today, I would like to declare an interest as a private landlord also myself. And like the previous speaker, I have also visited homes, seen photographs brought in by constituents of properties that are not fit or habitable. And these are not the type of properties that we want our constituents to be living in. So I too would urge that any review or reform of the housing selection scheme would take into consideration the state of those homes and whether they're habitable or not. There's no doubting that the current system is complex, and indeed it is very difficult for many of our constituents who are presenting to the Northern Ireland Housing Executive to understand the process in front of them. It can be a difficult and quite traumatic process for them. The issue of confidentiality was raised, and indeed I refer back to no less than 8 months ago when an individual was charged in our magistrates for a serious breach in confidentiality. And indeed, I've had ex-service personnel, indeed current serving personnel, come and approach me who have had fears of their confidentiality and concerns. And I believe that we need to address that not only when dealing with constituents, but indeed our service community also. I would urge the Minister to consider in any reform or review the military covenant, and indeed take that into consideration so that our service personnel, veterans and their families are not disadvantaged by virtue of their service. And it's important to point out, and I will reiterate, as my colleague Duke Beattie has been saying quite often, this is not about priority for service personnel, veterans or their families. It's about making sure where disadvantage may exist, it can be eradicated and understood by those who are implementing the policy. I would also urge the Minister to take into consideration post-separation. Indeed, from becoming an MLA in September 2015, my office has dealt with some 46% of our cases, which in relation to housing and housing repairs, and all of those, a quite substantial number, are in relation to post-separation, whereby there's no consideration given to the other partner of that separation, because they're not in receipt of child tax credit or child benefit, so they are not rewarded any points for separation. So we need to also look at that, because they do not receive those points in which they should be entitled to. Thus far, they do not progress up the point system. Thus far, they lie on the point system for a substantial amount of time, and we have children who are being disadvantaged because they cannot spend time with their mother or their father outside of the family home. There's no doubting, and it's important to mention, though, that the most recent statistics that I could obtained before this debate, Mr. Speaker, was that there's in the region of 40,000 individuals on the housing waiting list, and of that, 22,000 deemed to be in housing stress. That is a huge number, and we need to tackle that. And the way to tackle that is to start building the numbers of houses required to eradicate the housing stress. Also, Mr. Speaker, I think we need to tackle hidden homelessness, whereby individuals do not receive priority or full duty applicant points because they do not meet the current criteria. And we have a lot of people who, to use the term sofa surf, and they place a huge amount of, not so much burden, but reliance upon family and friends to put them up, to help them in the time of difficulty. While alleviating housing need must and should remain central to social housing allocations, giving the wider range of people a chance of getting a social home may build healthier communities and support job creation, social mobility and shared futures. The final point I would make, Mr. Speaker, is when taking into consideration any review or reform of the social housing scheme, we need to take into consideration the social size criteria, bedroom tax. How can we stand and penalise any of our constituents come 2021 post-mitigation when we aren't building an adequate level of social housing at a level where we need to help people to be able to downsize from 3- and 4-bedroom homes? If we're not able to help them transition from those homes to the smaller properties, which we aren't building enough of, we cannot penalise them with the bedroom tax. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Call Ms. Nicola Mallon.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I want to thank the member for bringing this motion today. There is no point in dressing it up. The housing selection scheme, and this is the crucial point, exacerbated by the shortage of housing, is broken, and it's time to replace it. Mr. Speaker, some might think this glib, but I got into politics to help people. And without question, the vast bulk of my constituency work is housing. And to be honest, Mr. Speaker, when I meet a constituent who needs help, and they tell me it's a housing issue, my heart sinks, because I know no matter how hard I work in that case, I won't be able to deliver a timely solution for them. And for some of them, they have already been living in housing stress for several years before they even come to see me. And why is this the case? Because, put simply, not enough social and affordable housing is being built, and the housing selection scheme is not fit for purpose. In fact, it is operating contrary to a number, if not all, of the system's founding principles. The principle of prioritisation based on greatest housing need, of fairness and equity, of openness, of consistency in application, of value for money, and certainly in my constituency, Mr. Speaker, of choice in where to live. Those of us who deal with housing issues on a daily basis We know that the system is being abused by some and to the detriment of the many, many genuine, not least, as members have pointed out, when it comes to intimidation, for example. Yes, there are genuine intimidation cases, and that must be recognised and they must be supported. But we also know that there is a surge in intimidation cases reported to the Housing Executive in the rundown to the release of a new social housing development. Why? Because the current selection scheme under it points mean prizes, and an intimidation case awards 200 points and guarantees escalation to the top end of the list. We also know of successful applications in terms of intimidation points for people with known track records when it comes to antisocial behaviour. The outworkings of this system in the cases I have referred to means that very problematic tenants are simply moved around and they become concentrated in new developments and a whole new cycle of problems begin. The current assessment of intimidation case says access to transfer for tenants with antisocial behaviour records. It requires urgent reform, as does the recognition of homelessness in temporary accommodation and the recognition given to unsuitable accommodation, not least for people with disabilities, who in my view are the biggest victims of the housing crisis. As members have said here, there have been a number of reviews of the selection scheme. What we need now is the Minister to bring forward a series of recommendations for its replacement and for that to go out to public consultation. But I will end by saying this, Mr. Speaker. Behind every statistic is a human story, and their fate is determined by the system. A system often established by a group of bureaucrats, far removed from the experiences, the lives of those that system will dictate to and define. If I could share with you just a few examples from my own constituency. A father fighting for custody of his child in the care of social services almost lost her because he didn't have enough points to secure a suitable property with the extra bedroom social services said was an essential prerequisite for full custody. A young family, a father, a mother and their two children, waking up this morning for the 608th morning in a hostel they were told was only ever going to be a temporary crisis intervention. Because they, despite their best efforts, despite the best efforts of the hostel staff and myself, we can't get them anywhere near the level of points required to get a house in North Belfast where their children go to school. A disabled grandmother who has full custody of her three grandchildren, two of which have disabilities, because her daughter, their mother, lost her life in tragic circumstances. At the very last minute, she was overtaken by intimidation cases and she lost out on a new built property which was perfect for their physical, mental, emotional, social and educational needs. Mr. Speaker, this is the human impact of the current housing selection scheme. This is why it can no longer continue to operate as is. But in reforming it, in replacing it, there must be proper transition role arrangements. But above all else, Mr. Speaker, and I will end with this, unless thousands of more houses are built and bungalows are built and no longer deemed not worth building because they're not profitable, then any reform of the assessment scheme will be a meaningless paper exercise. And if that is the case, then all of us should be ashamed.
I call Mr. Stuart Dixon.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I also rise to support the motion in front of the House this afternoon. Housing has been and indeed remains an extremely contested area in this community and this society in Northern Ireland, both in terms of its provision and also in terms of its allocation. The work of the Northern Ireland Housing Executive and the Common Selection Scheme does ensure equality and fairness, but we need to deliver better than that for our citizens into the future. We need to ensure that any scheme continues to deliver equity, fairness and transparency. None of those things should be underestimated in any allocation scheme. With some 40,000 waiting to gain access to the scheme or to housing, it's important to remember that many of the individuals and families, and others have given good examples around this chamber this afternoon, have a variety of circumstances and reasons why they need to have appropriate housing. Those that face housing stress use the current common selection scheme because it is supposed to focus on securing housing for those in need. Yet it is quite often those in need that the system fails, as referred to by colleagues, in relation to living in hostels, family circumstances, and all of the issues that arrive on our doorsteps in MLA constituency offices. I accept that no system is perfect. However, and of course we are all aware of the incidents in which the current points-based system is and can be manipulated, often out of genuine desperation, by those who see no prospect of being rehoused within a reasonable time frame. Equally sadly, all of us have to deal with those of victims of real intimidation and indeed survivors and victims of the past, whose current housing need is completely unsuited to their deteriorating health and conditions. We need to ensure that any new system continues to protect those people without incentivising poor behaviour. Accordingly, a replacement must be sought for the housing selection scheme. There are many recommendations in a joint University of Ulster and University of Cambridge paper on this matter, but three areas should be of particular importance both to this House and to the Minister when considering a review of the housing selection scheme. Firstly, moving away from the current points-based system would allow us to move to what's described as an active choice-based approach. This would allow people to see what is happening within the social housing market and to actively bid for properties that they're entitled to. On the surface, this would increase people's participation in the rehousing process, and research has shown that this will increase the success of obtaining a property. I would.
And it's just interesting, the argument then around choice-based lettings. You know, most of this is based, and certainly the proposals, of what was available in huge housing estates in England, where there were many hundreds of houses laying empty. What is happening here is that people are being offered choice-based lettings in areas where there are already difficulties, and when them houses are allocated, it actually adds to the difficulties that exist within those communities.
And can I say,
thank you,
Deputy Speaker, and can I say to Mr McCann, I wholly respect what he is saying, but if he will allow me to develop what I will ultimately come to is the point, and I'll make it now rather than later on, is that quite simply, not only do we need to review the scheme, but we need to ultimately actually provide a much wider choice in properties that are available. That includes building them, providing it through other innovative schemes and methodologies of doing that. So if we can widen the base, then that will allow people, what I genuinely think people want to do, is to be able to choose the appropriate type of house they should be living in, not have it chosen for them or indeed thrust upon them, which is so often the problem that we face in Northern Ireland. The current common selection scheme is one that shouldn't be the only option for people in Northern Ireland, and we need to invest much more heavily in co-ownership and also encourage people to become involved in mutual exchanges. And we should also be looking to develop other types of housing that will deliver for most people in need in our communities. Mr Speaker, Minister Given recently highlighted to the committee that £6.5 billion is needed over the next 30 years to address the upkeep of social housing in Northern Ireland. With the lack of uncertainty, with the lack of certainty regarding funding, we must ensure that this is done and that we use all of the best and most innovative ways of delivering housing so that we can take the stress away from people's need to select the appropriate accommodation for them and their families and for their particular lifestyle in terms of employment, age, and medical and other conditions. It is important that we do that, but it's important that we do that, Mr Speaker, recognising that we need to move to a more integrated and open society that allows people to live where they want to live in a society that is shared and open for everyone. And certainly the Alliance Party is happy to support the Minister in bringing forward appropriate recommendations for public discussion in relation to housing selection. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Mr Christopher Stalford.
Mr Deputy Speaker, sir, thank you. I'm happy to support the motion, and I thank Frau McCann for bringing it in front of the Assembly. I think it's timely that he has done so. I think the Department for Communities Committee does have an over-representation, I think, of Belfast Assembly members, and I think one of the reasons for that is because all the best people are on that committee. No, I think one of the reasons for that is because, as a Belfast Assembly member, I know that, much like my colleague from East Belfast, Andy Allen, the huge majority of my time is spent dealing with housing issues. And I'm sure that that would be a common experience across the city. But actually, I suspect most Assembly members, a huge chunk of their time is taken up by housing matters. One of the issues that hasn't been touched upon in the debate up until this point that I do think is important is the way in which the present fund or the present points system actively undermines the sustainability of communities. I say that because time and again, and I particularly think of communities like Balnafai, time and again people have come to me seeking accommodation in the area where they were born and reared, where their family network is, where they have roots in the community. But because of the blunt way in which the point system operates, they find it impossible. I mean, for example, I think if you're looking something in Annadale, 200 points plus, you're going to need to be certain of getting something there. So people that were born in those communities and were reared in them oftentimes find it impossible to stay in them. And I hope that as we're reforming the system, that there will be some recognition put into the system of, as has been said, people choosing where to live and people who want to live in the areas where they were born and reared being afforded at least some recognition of that desire inside the points system. Mention has been made, and I agree, mention has been made of the total lack of dignity that housing executive clients are left with going through the process of declaring homeless. I have been in situations similar to those that have been described by other colleagues around the chamber. For a person who's representing someone to go with them to that experience is hard, but for the person who's actually on the receiving end of the process, it is humiliating. Oftentimes, to sit in front of, as has been said, a bureaucrat and pour out the most intimate details of your situation, and oftentimes to feel as though you're not getting a response, you're not being spoken to like a human being, you're not being treated fairly or with dignity. And so I do think reform of that aspect of the housing allocation system is certainly something that I think would be welcomed. One of the issues as well that's already been mentioned, but I do think it's important, is the abuse of the whole area of intimidation. And as has been said, you'll suddenly see a massive rise in the claims of intimidation when housing is about to be released. And I think the thing that has frustrated me many times is that often the people who are awarded the additional points for claiming intimidation are the selfsame people who made the lives of their neighbours and the communities in which they had previously lived utterly wretched. And they, people looking at the system, see that the, yes, I will, yes, of course.
That point, because there are many of those that claim intimidation, put down as their areas of choice, 200 yards down the road or half a mile down the road, when they say that their lives are in danger. So it makes a nonsense of the whole thing.
Members, an extra moment. A minute.
The member's absolutely right, and we've all seen that before, where people claiming intimidation points are oftentimes those who, as I say, were making the lives of their neighbours wretched, but they're so intimidated, as he says, they want merely to move you know, a few streets away or a couple of hundred yards from the place where they were supposedly being intimidated. We've seen, as public representatives, all of the many flaws that there are within the system, and I welcome the fact that the Minister is here today, and I hope that he'll be able to answer some of the questions that have been raised. One of the issues that I have had experience of as a constituency representative is particularly for young men who want to live in the places where where they were born. And I mean, in vast swathes of my constituency, if you're a man under 30 with no dependents, you can forget about it, because it's just not going to happen. And we do need to make some provision, some recognition for that particular group of people within society, in order that they can stay in the places where they were born and they were reared. We all know the reasons, and there's no need to rehash them or rehearse them. We all know the reasons why this system was introduced. But I believe that we have moved forward as a society to the point where meaningful reform of this system can be introduced that will be able to command the support of every party in this House. So I welcome the motion, and I thank, I nearly said thank Councillor McCann, I thank Frau McCann for bringing it. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Mr. Raymond McCartney.
And Mr. Stafford, who was talked about the Communities Committee being populated by people from Belfast. And I'm neither from Belfast nor I'm a member of the committee, but I can assure you that housing is an item which obviously concentrates the minds of, I would say, every single MLA in the Assembly. The motion today, tabled by Sinn Féin, is very, very straightforward, in it asks the Minister to, if you like, re-examine, take a fresh look at housing allocation and how we allocate houses in terms of need. And I think that's very, very important. And both when Frau McCaw introduced or proposed the motion, and when Nicola Mallon was speaking, they talked about the principles, the core principles around the allocation of houses. And I think they're sound and remain sound. That's the idea of a system based on openness, transparency, following the need, allocating on need in a very equitable way. And I think we should continue that, because in the main, whereas aspects of the system is broken, there's other aspects of it which remain sound, and that's the basis on which we should go forward. People here today already, I think we have seen a degree of unanimity that people feel that this is an appropriate time to have a review, but we want it based on the system which is already in place around those principles as outlined. People have went down the other avenues around, you know, areas of high demand, the need for more housing, and I think that does contribute to the debate and the need for more housing, particularly in areas of high demand. And I would live in Derry, and that's obviously, the Minister would be aware, is an area of high demand. So we have to find ways of how we address that. But when it comes to the actual point system, and I think most people would agree, at least the point system allows people some sort of openness. It's measurable, and then people can, if you like, measure it against the criteria set by the housing executive and our housing providers. But there's one aspect of it, and some members have previously touched on it, and I think it's an important aspect of the review which the Minister, I hope, will take forward in relation to this, and it is certainly around how points are allocated for intimidation. You do have a situation where what's described perhaps as social or community intimidation receives 20 points, but if it's intimidation by paramilitaries or armed groups, it's 200 points. The point has been well made, and it's a living experience, and I'm sure if the Minister does undertake this review, then I hope they will look at particularly the phenomena where you have new housing developments, and when there's a new housing development that reaches the allocation phase, then everybody involved in the system will tell you that there's a spike in the number, particularly of what are called paramilitary intimidation. And I think we need to examine that to protect ourselves, because the experience, and we have seen it recently in Derry, where maybe over 300 houses have been allocated over maybe the space of maybe 8 or 9 months. A lot of people come away disappointed from that system, because when on the cusp of the allocation, they're told by everybody concerned that they have enough points, and then afterwards they're told that you failed, and the reason why you failed is that someone got 200 points for intimidation. They go away feeling cheated by the system, and I think we have to move to eradicate that. I also think it's an appropriate time with the review that the Minister would be seeking to ensure that this sort of idea of third parties verifying intimidation is something which also should be examined. It is my belief, and it's our party belief, that unless the people report intimidation directly to the PSNI, then the allocation of points should be maybe looked at, examined, because I think that there's no one has any reason now to go to third parties. And it does allow, and it would put a degree of, if you like, pressure on the PSNI, because the experience in PSNI personnel will tell you sometimes threats of intimidation, particularly Mr. Roundhousen, aren't investigated in the way that they should. So it becomes nearly, I think someone said, it's nearly like a free way of getting a house very quickly. And I think we have to remove that, because I can say from experience, and I'm sure it's the experience of all members, that the biggest disappointment and the thing that people decry the system most for is that they feel they're on the cusp of being awarded a house fairly, and then all of a sudden it's taken away from them by a process which everybody agrees is flawed. And I think that would be one of the main planks of the Minister's review, to have a look at intimidation. Romila Mayogat, Alaskan Collier.
Thank you very much. I call Jenny Palmer.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and can I thank the member also for bringing forward the motion. I'm happy to speak on this motion. I agree with the principle involved in the motion, and that any replacement of the housing selection scheme must be fairer and more transparent than what came before. Mr. Speaker, there are a number of grievous flaws with the current scheme. We all recognise that. We've heard the members across the chamber concurring with each other on the issues on the housing selection scheme. I'm not going to use the main body of my speech just to list all of what is wrong, but it is important to highlight a few key areas, and indeed some of these areas have already been highlighted. That's how important it is to our members within this Assembly that we deal with on a daily basis. We have an exciting opportunity to improve upon what has been a broken and at times deeply unfair system. I hope that the Minister intends to grasp his chance with both hands to amend this. Firstly, it's important to recognise that in the past, young men have been proactively discriminated against in the housing selection scheme in cases of marriage breakdown. The assumption was that the woman, in particular mothers who had majority custody of the children, were given the priority, but this was only partially due to the lack of housing, which is still an issue, but it's a problem that has yet to be addressed. It is also understandable that the well-being of children was central to decision-making. However, the outflow of this was the creation of a significant class of young, vulnerable men who often had nowhere to go, and we've heard about the couch surfing in the room, and they've become victims of crime, or they've become involved in crime, or even worse, that they have suffered poor mental health as a consequence of the system that is failing them. Any new scheme must take this into account and seek to address the imbalance. Secondly, Mr. Speaker, I must wonder why it's not possible to have two lists for housing need. An A list, A, for those without specific considerations, and B, for those in more urgent special circumstances. My fellow members across the chamber will know that the overwhelming majority of housing cases we deal with are emergencies. People dealing with disabilities, victims of intimidation, or those with large families. What this means is that those falling outside those critical criteria are often left in the shuffle. We need a system that both addresses the seriousness of those in grave need of housing, but does not leave all the others to languish in temporary accommodation because of the poor points system. Having two lists would be a step forward and allow for a better joined-up approach in dealing with housing allocation. It would mean that those in the most urgent need will be automatically prioritised, but that those who are still in need but not in special categories are not simply allowed to languish. Finally, Mr. Speaker, I would like to ask the Minister to consider how the Department deals with the issues of antisocial behaviour and intimidation. We've heard it all. We've heard all the members talk about it. While these are charities and they do their best, I feel it's unreasonable to rely so heavily on their assessments. I would argue that on the way forward, that this is a service that should rightfully be carried out by the Department. It should not be farmed out to charities. All allocations and assessments ought to be handled by a central unit within the department. Furthermore, community consultation is an important part of many of the housing allocations. However, its use ought to be reformed. We've heard about the intimidation. We've heard about the bullets in the post. We've heard about all of the resettlement payments. Well, we haven't actually, but there are resettlement payments for those who have been deemed to have been intimidated. And it's maybe £600 to resettle into a new area. Now, whoever wrote and sent the bullet in the post, they get a percentage of that. So that's the deal. That's the deal that's cut across Northern Ireland. That's the corruption of the system, and we need to address that system urgently. The B list, that is with special considerations additionally, there is an obvious need for anonymous consultation to protect the proposed tenants. There should not be a community veto on proposed tenants, and more must be done to proactively protect people moving into or living in areas from away from paramilitary threats.
I ask the member to conclude her remarks. Thank you.
We cannot, Mr. Speaker, allow paramilitaries to pick and choose whose lives in what area, while due concern and care must be given to the genuine threats. If we continue to allow so-called community vetoes, we are increasing the stranglehold that paramilitaries have over communities. The role of the community representation in housing allocation must be urgently reviewed. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
I call Mr. Daniel McCrossan.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I welcome the opportunity to participate in today's debate and on such an important issue, an issue that is plaguing my constituency of West Tyrone and many others, as we've heard in this House today, an issue that has left tens of thousands of vulnerable and helpless people across the North without adequate housing. The supply of a good standard of housing is a basic human need, and when you come from a constituency that is rife with deprivation and unemployment, social housing is absolutely paramount for children to ensure that they have a roof over their heads and to ensure that they get the best possible start in life. That should be a priority for this Assembly in this new mandate. Some would say that the provision of social housing is reaching crisis point. I would strongly argue, listening to today's contributions from the members, that we are at crisis point, and I hope the Minister is listening strongly to the concerns of the members. There has not been the necessary investment in new social homes, while the existing stock is soon becoming outdated and is coming into a state of disrepair due to the delay in maintenance projects, which is ongoing. As my colleagues and others have highlighted, waiting lists for social housing are at an all-time high, and I think it's important that we continue to repeat this number. 40,000 people are on waiting lists, Minister. Some 22,000 of those are in housing stress, and 10,000 are deemed to be homeless. Mr. Speaker, this House, through past decades, has completely failed many of these people who are the most vulnerable, marginalised and helpless in our society, and in this year's budget and in draft programme for government, I do not see any meaningful attempt from this government to address this issue. The Minister has stated during his opening statement to the Committee for Communities that his vision is to ensure that everyone can have access to good quality housing at a reasonable cost, and that he intends to have 1,600 social housing homes built across the North this year. I welcome that announcement, Minister. But West Tyrone alone, Mr. Deputy Speaker, has suffered for years with little to no new housing builds. In fact, the waiting list in my constituency is, as articulated by others, at an all-time high, with 1,400 people on waiting lists, 600 deemed to be in housing stress. There has been little or no reduction in this number in the last 10 years, Mr. Deputy Speaker. That is a reflection of the failure of this House to meet the most basic needs of our community. It is of no surprise, as since 2011, West Tyrone has had the lowest number of new builds of any constituency across the North. This has left many individuals and families, especially those with young children and suffering disability, in a state of anxiety and depression. Given the chronic waiting list for social housing and the rise of homelessness in Strabane, I am glad that the Minister is finally taking notice and is directing some resources to Strabane by committing to build 105 new social housing units for the Strabane area. But this, Mr. Deputy Speaker, is only the tip of the iceberg and will not resolve the impending crisis. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I want a commitment that these proposed bills actually happen on time, and I stress the need to the new Minister for further new build programmes across the entirety of the West Tyrone area. Turning to the selection process, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that has dominated today's debate, there are some serious issues with the process, and I see it every day, as other members have highlighted, the very real issues in our communities. I'll give you a few quick examples. As a mother of three children, very young, a single, went into a hostel. She's there now 8 months, and there is no sign of having her housed. She's in desperation, living in very poor circumstances. Another is, I was speaking to staff in the Housing Executive, morale is at an all-time low. The one lady said that she's worked for the Housing Executive from its foundation and has never seen things as bad. Mr Deputy Speaker, in most instances, temporary emergency accommodation is provided, but this can be anywhere across Northern Ireland, which removes the family and friends support structure that exists. Things are very, very bad. Just last week, I was aware of a gentleman that passed away, and by the time I got back from his funeral, four people had called my office to ask, was there any possibility to get that house? Desperation is the term we must use. To conclude, Mr Deputy Speaker, I'm aware that today is the starting point of the new Assembly term, and I am glad that this issue has been raised for debate. There exists serious need for new social housing, and it is my view and the view of the SDLP that such need can only be met with new bills. Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker.
Thank you. I call Stephen Agnew.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker. We need to build more houses. We need to build more houses, as has been pointed out. We have 40,000 people on our waiting list. And Jonathan Bell was the first to raise the issue of honesty when people seek a home and seek to get as high as they can up the points list. The reality is people will do what they need to do to get housed and to get appropriate and suitable accommodation for them and in some cases their families. And when constituents come to us, we're complicit in this system by necessity of the system that exists and ensuring the people who come to us get the maximum points available to them. Now, I hope, and I'm certainly not suggesting that anyone in this House is encouraging people to get intimidated, but we ensure that they get the points that they're entitled to, and hopefully we do no more. But there'll be those who don't come to our offices, who maybe aren't getting that support. And it's those who are more proactive and those who know their way around the system who will get the extra points, who will get the extra support, who will get themselves up the housing list. The motion calls for a fair system. That is not a fair system. We need to build new houses. We need to build more social houses. And we need at this point in time, I believe, to suspend and review the right to buy, because we are chasing our tails, and whilst sales are down from the peak in terms of the right to buy scheme, we're still selling off when we have an insufficient stock.
We actually discussed that point last week, that at a high there was 220,000 houses under Housing Executive's control. It's now down to 88,000. And whilst a new build is crucially important to rehousing people, also the policy of relets brings thousands of houses. But as you continue to sell off your houses, it lessens that and drives more people onto housing waiting lists.
I thank the member for his intervention, and what he highlights is the slow privatisation of our public housing sector. And we're allowing it to continue. And I think it's time to suspend, to look at this again, and decide if it's the way we want to go forward. We also need to bring our existing stock up to standard. And we need to take as a basic principle that where possible, we keep people in their homes. Because currently, by and large, what we do, if somebody comes to us and say their current accommodation is unsuitable, is we move them. There's obviously expense in that, and reference has been made to some of the grants for resettlement. But we just shift the problem. In some cases, we'll put somebody else into that house who will later claim it'll be unsuitable. We need to make sure our houses are suitable, make the adaptations, improve the standard. We need to do it at a strategic level across the board, but we need, where possible, to do it for those individuals, whether it's disability adaptations or just improving the quality of the building they're in. The housing selection scheme itself does need reformed, and we have conflated two connected but separate issues: housing need and personal circumstances. And I think until we separate those things, see them as separate, and come back to the principle of housing need first, then I think we're going to continue with the problems that members have highlighted here today. We need to ensure, yes, that we put people in appropriate housing, that we do assess their personal need and their circumstances to ensure we get that right. But in terms of priority, it should be about housing need, not personal circumstances. If we get back to that principle, we can address some of the issues that have been raised. But the reality is, if there aren't enough houses, there aren't enough solutions. And that has to be where we start. We have to build more social housing. We have to invest in the social housing that we have to make sure it's up to an adequate standard, to make sure it accommodates lifelong living, and to make sure that people who want to stay in their homes can stay in their homes and aren't having to move because of damp, because it's affecting, poor quality is affecting their health, because they can't afford to heat energy inefficient homes. If we do that, then the importance of the scheme that we use to prioritise becomes less important. Get the first part right, and the second part almost takes care of itself.
Thank you. I call Mr. Jerry Carroll.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I welcome the opportunity to discuss this motion, especially as it's an issue of particular importance in my own constituency in West Belfast, which has some of the largest waiting lists across the north, where it's not unusual for people to wait 5 years or a lot longer to get housed. And I think this is an important topic which needs to be addressed. And I think, whilst it has to be said, there are people who ideologically want to break up the housing executive, I think we have to defend the principle of public housing, but also ask, do we have the best system for allocating social housing? I think, obviously, the motion comes from one of the executive parties. I think it is a bit cloak and dagger to say get rid of the present system of allocation without Sinn Féin indicating what the replacement system would be. And the system is not perfect. I wouldn't claim that it is, but I think it would be helpful and useful to this debate if we saw the proposed replacement scheme in front of us. I would, yeah.
Interesting that you missed it, because you know what my record is in housing in West Belfast over many, many years, and I think it's a bit much for yourself to come up and accuse the executive parties who work tirelessly, and certainly in West Belfast, in dealing with housing issues, and have done over a long period of time. See the system that you're talking about, it's broken. Everybody knows that it's broken, so something needs to be done to fix it. Have I got all the answers? No, I haven't, and I'm sure you haven't got the answers either. What we're talking about is the minister to go away and come back with a solution that allows us to deal with it, not coming off with...
But like I said, there's no proposal in front of us. There's no proposal in front of us, so I think that would be helpful and useful to debate to have the alternative system of points allocation in front of us to help us better inform this debate. And Mr. Deputy Speaker, every week our constituency office is inundated with requests about housing, I'm sure as other people are. People who are in dire need of housing, people who are sleeping on sofas, people who are living in overcrowded housing, people who are living in accommodation that is covered with damp, people who have accommodation that doesn't match their needs. I think the question we have to ask is the current allocation scheme, is it working for these people? I think we also have to ask, Mr. Deputy Speaker, under the current allocation of points, as has been previously mentioned,
or people with disabilities getting the points that they are entitled to? What about people with mental health issues in our society? We know that in some cases people do get points for mental health issues, but in some cases it's only a small allocation of points, and it doesn't reflect their daily lives and the fact that mental health issues can be a daily issue for these people. So I think under a new system and a new point of allocation, I think mental health has to be central to the allocation of housing points. I think the issue of asylum seekers and marginalised groups in society has to be looked at, and we have to ask the question, are they getting all the assistance that's needed from the Housing Executive and other bodies? And any future selection system has to address the fact, Mr Deputy Speaker, that an asylum seeker is not currently entitled to be on the social housing waiting list or receive housing benefit, even if an assessment would find them eligible. I think also the issue of housing in North Belfast has to be tackled, Mr Deputy Speaker. I think it cannot be brushed under the carpet for another Assembly term. I think it's unacceptable that 75% of the people on the housing waiting list in North Belfast are from the nationalist community who are experiencing severe housing stress. Yet the allocation doesn't reflect this inequality. And we've witnessed examples in the past where the system has been exploited by ministers using sectarianism to provide more housing for one community, despite the need pointing in a completely different direction. This kind of practice has to come to an end, and allocation should be based on need, not what's in the best interest for a minister. I think in terms of the debates about intimidation, Mr Deputy Speaker, I think it is quite worrying in terms of the tone of the debate. I think it seems to be an attempt, or it comes across certainly, as an attempt to pit people against each other without pointing to the real issue which is being discussed and made already, the real issue being the lack of social housing. And I think it's concerning to hear talks of a scrapping of intimidation points. I think it's risky to scrap what can often be a safety net for people, such as providing intimidation points without any concrete evidence provided here this evening that the current system isn't working. Safety measures need to exist for vulnerable people under any new system, and of course there are absolutely real claims of intimidation. Indeed, I've had people approaching me who cannot get points for intimidation despite being intimidated. And of course, one way to ensure that people aren't stuck on the housing waiting list for years, Mr Deputy Speaker, trying to get points, trying to do what they can to get points, is to ensure there are enough properties to house everyone on the housing waiting list. And this can be done by a crash housing building programme employing thousands of brickies, plasterers, plumbers and other tradespeople, providing jobs and also providing thousands of homes, tens of thousands of homes for people who need them. And this would be an important point, and if the political will was there to do it, it could be done. And to conclude, Mr Deputy Speaker, I will be supporting this motion because it is calling for a fairer and more transparent allocation system. However, it doesn't mean People Before Profit will give blanket support to whatever the executive will propose to replace it with. We will look at the proposed replacement when it comes to the floor and decide then whether the replacement scheme is indeed fair and transparent before we decide to support any proposals.
Thank you. I call the Minister for Communities, Mr Paul Given, to respond.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker, and can I thank the members that have brought this motion today and for the contributions that have been made from right across the House. The motion does give me the opportunity to tell the Assembly about the important work that's being done by my department in reviewing the Housing Selection Scheme, which has been in operation more or less unchanged since 2000. Other members have also raised issues and questions about the scheme in their own contributions so far this afternoon, and I'll seek to address some of those in my remarks later. Under a commitment, Mr Deputy Speaker, made in the current housing strategy, a fundamental review of the allocation of social housing in Northern Ireland is being led by my department. In the first phase of the review, academics were commissioned to deliver independent recommendations. These were published in late 2013, and we received more than 40 written responses to those recommendations. We are now in the second phase of the review. My department is preparing proposals for public consultation, and I'll be giving those proposals my full consideration and expect to publish them later this year. Let me assure the tablers of the motion and the rest of the Assembly that when these proposals are published, they will find them to be supported by evidence and informed by independent research. I'm committed to ensuring that the housing selection scheme is fair and transparent, a commitment which is reflected in the outcomes that I want to deliver as a result of changes to the scheme. I am considering five outcomes at present, which I will outline for members now, outcomes which I believe clearly address the fundamentals of the motion that we have before us today to ensure a fair and transparent system of assessing housing need. First, the outcome of any review must be to deliver a greater range of solutions to meet housing need. Second, there must be an improved system for the most vulnerable applicants. Third, I want to see a more accurate waiting list that reflects the current housing circumstances of those on the list. Fourth, and this is unquestionably the most important outcome, I want to see that those in greatest housing need receive priority. Finally, I want any changes to the scheme to enable better use of public resources by ensuring that the waiting list moves smoothly. That is my vision for a renewed housing selection scheme. While I'll give the detailed proposals careful consideration before publishing them, I'm glad of this opportunity to set out some key elements that have emerged during the research and evidence gathering phase. The response to the independent research recommendations have shown that on the whole the scheme has a high level of public support. There's strong support for the existing principles of universal access to social housing in Northern Ireland. This principle means any adult can apply for a home if they meet the eligibility criteria. I expect any changes to the scheme to retain this principle of universal access. Another area that was strongly supported in the first phase of the review was the recommendation that an independent, tenure-neutral housing advice service should be established. This service should offer advice to help households meet their housing need and find or keep suitable accommodation in any tenure. Clients could be assisted in applying for a social home, looking for private rented accommodation, getting support to where they are, or considering co-ownership or full home ownership. There was broad support for this recommendation, and there have been positive outcomes from a similar pilot housing solutions scheme run by the Housing Executive. I'm aware of some criticism of how the housing options model has developed elsewhere and the accusation that it is simply about improving the statistics. Well, let me be clear, that is not its purpose. I want to see a service put in place that assists people into the housing solutions that are right for them. In many cases, people need help to stay in their own home or help to access housing in any tenure. The aim of a housing option service is that it is targeted to individuals' needs and delivers better outcomes for them. It is a tailored, bespoke approach as opposed to a one-size-fits-all. My officials are therefore considering this proposal as part of the review. Another area under consideration is the current status of intimidation points in the existing scheme. This is clearly an issue that many stakeholders have very strong views about. My concern is with the outcome. Do intimidation points help us to achieve the desired outcome, namely that those in the highest housing need receive priority in the allocation of housing? I have to say that I'm not convinced. Applicants with intimidation points do not, on average, to be housed quickly. And when considering actual housing circumstances, applicants with intimidation points often have very few underlying housing issues. But because of their intimidation, when they are housed, it is ahead of other applicants who are often living in much poorer housing circumstances. Let me give you an example. In the current scheme, a household that is intimidated will receive 200 points because of that intimidation, 70 points because the intimidation renders them homeless, and a further 20 points because they were threatened with violence. That's 290 points in total. Compare that with a household that is homeless because of domestic violence and sharing with another family simply because they've nowhere else to go. In the current scheme, they will receive 70 points because they are homeless, 20 because they are threatened with violence. They get 40 points because they have to share, and possibly 20 points because they're also overcrowded. If they have been on the waiting list for a number of years, they might get up to 10 points because of that time. That's 160 points altogether in comparison to 290 points received in the intimidation case. In some areas, families in serious housing need are waiting and will continue to wait, precisely because households with the 200-plus intimidation points always receive overriding priority. I believe it's time for change. As a society, we have moved on. Our policies should also move on. I want to examine in detail whether removing intimidation points from the scheme would be beneficial for people in the worst physical housing circumstances. Exploring this option, I would also want to ensure that people who have to leave their homes because of intimidation would not be disadvantaged. Our legislation is clear that they would continue to be recognised as homeless and they should be awarded points within the scheme on that basis. But they would be on a more equal footing with, for example, those who are homeless due to fire, flood, or those who have experienced domestic violence. This is one of a number of proposals which the review has explored and which I am considering publishing for public consultation later this year. Briefly, in a couple of minutes, let me address some of the points that some members have raised. Across the House, people have mentioned that more resources are needed. I agree with that. The debate that Mr Carroll talked about in terms of an attack on public housing, I would suggest those who want to get a house care not if it's provided through public finances or indeed private finances. They want a house, and that's what will drive me in terms of taking forward proposals to try and provide for those who need it. Mr Allen raised the issue of the social size, the bedroom tax, and it comes into this point about a range of issues, not just dealing with this in isolation, because we have the reform, social housing reform agenda, and there's a range of issues to address that, which also impacts upon how you access funding to provide the housing that's needed. But obviously, in the future, social size bedroom tax will become an issue. But I make the point, this Assembly has set aside £91 million as a result of the Fresh Start agreement that was made by the two parties, and that has ensured that people over the next period of time will not have to pay the bedroom tax, a taxation policy that his party joined up with the Ulster Unionists on and campaigning for in a previous Westminster election and agreed to take the whip had they been elected to Westminster, which then brought in the bedroom tax. So the member may wish to reflect on the genesis of the way how the bedroom tax came into being and the parties which are acting to ensure it doesn't have a detrimental impact. Other members have raised a variety of issues which I just simply don't have the time to raise, but I'd seek to provide some responses to them in writing. What I would say, I want to have people provided housing on the basis of need. Mr Carroll introduced a very sectarian element to the debate today about nationalist housing in North Belfast. And what I would say that as a society, we would hope to have left those days behind us. And let me give the assurance to the member that we want to address people's needs, not on the basis of their identity, but because they need housing to be provided for them. So in conclusion, Mr Deputy Speaker, the housing selection scheme is complex by nature, and therefore I want to see a suite of proposals which can, taken together, deliver the outcomes that I have set out to you today. Those outcomes are based on assessing housing need accurately and efficiently, and will therefore also support many of the proposed programme for government outcomes and indeed the purpose of the programme's framework to improve wellbeing for all. Can I thank members for those remarks and conclude, Mr Deputy Speaker.
Thank you. I call Karen McCullen to wind up the debate and conclude. Thank you.
Gormeogat, Las Can Cola, and indeed it's rare at the start of an Assembly term that we'll have a debate where, despite some of the comments, it seems that we're going to receive and enjoy cross-party support, by and large, for a motion that everybody, I believe, essentially has a real sense of commitment to. I mean, first of all, I think Fran McCann, regardless of where you sit in this House, is recognised as being, I was going to say passionate, and then it broke off, passionate about housing, so we'll just get that across. But Fran McCann has led the way in terms of housing based on need for many, many decades. And, you know, even going back to the days in Belfast City Council, and in the housing executive. I've seen other members of other political parties contacting Fra and others about advice, and he's given it freely, and he's given it with an open heart. And indeed, that's the spirit in which we come to this motion. I also want to thank the research teams. I believe the research pack's very good. It'll actually help some of the charities and some of the groups out there working around housing issues. Without going through systematically, and I know this happens when we're waiting at debates with different members of state, I think we're all here and we'll remain for the debates, so we've heard all that. But certainly there are common themes that are coming through. I think people believe, are very passionate, and they're very concerned that the public housing element of the housing executive stays as it is, and that's crucial. But what we're saying is the system that we have, and the Minister's confirmed that it hasn't been reviewed from 2000, is broken. It's not working. I think one of the other things I think I'd like to clarify is that some of the staff working in the offices also have complained to us as political representatives that the conditions that they're working in order to hear confidential cases, aren't fit for purpose, and they're looking just to fix those. Some of those staff hear very harrowing cases, and they aren't happy with what they're hearing either, and they're not happy with the advice within the current system that they're giving people, so they're looking to us to make change. It's not their fault that we're all walking into a crowded room and overhearing each other's conversations. It's our fault that that's happening, so we need to sort that out. I also want to pick up on a few points, and I just want to say it to be clear. When we're talking about need, we are talking about need. We're not talking about creed. Everybody said that. We're talking about objective need. And the way in which objective need is measured will stand the test of time, particularly if there's going to be a review in this situation. And that too will be as part of a public consultation. Just very slightly, Christopher.
The member would agree, throughout the debate, the only contribution that sought to divide the House in terms of orange and green came from our friend who's supposed to be neither, and red down in the corner.
Red, Christopher, so it's one of my favourite colours, but one thing I will take exception to. See, I have no issue. This place is for bringing politics in, so let's not gurn about that. What I do have an issue is style over substance, and I don't like popularism. I think it's really cowardly. And I think also pointing fingers on the basis that people have different political points of view is a wee bit silly as well. I do think we need to take this from a basis of evidence. Now, if people expected us to bring an alternative without consultation, that would have been a problem, and I think Gerry's big enough to accept that as well. And we had to make a point for the sake of making a point, but for Fran McCann to throw an alternative out to housing without any public consultation, first of all, it's not in his gift, he's not a minister yet. But he's not. That's a minister's job, that's a department's job, and then it's our job to tear that consultation apart. And better still, if we're coming out from a good position, it's our job to make that consultation better in order to make it better for the people we represent. What I have absolutely no tolerance for is people coming in and making assumptions and points and not actually backing it up with real evidence yet, but I dare say people will grow into that. It is a fact, and it's not to be sectarian, but it is a fact that in my constituency, and Nicola Mann's constituency, that at times, and Williams as well, at times you can have from 70% to 81.3% of people on the housing waiting list are deemed nationalist. Now that's a challenge. What I won't accept, and I don't think any member of this House would accept, that that's allowed to prevail because a lot of Catholics live in North Belfast, and I'm not saying that. However, what I will say is, if we're building houses and creating communities, it has to be on the basis of need. It has to be on the basis of need. And I'll give way very, very quickly.
I appreciate the member giving way. Just to put the record straight, and I appreciate the member giving way when the member for West Belfast incorrectly gave figures of this House which misled it. I have to say that the figures across North Belfast, across the four housing executive offices in North Belfast, are not 75% or 80%, but 50-50. And the point that I would simply make is this. In supporting what the Minister has said, where there is need, my party is absolutely committed to addressing that need, regardless of the background, religion or creed of any of those people.
I'm delighted to hear that, and I'm delighted to hear that, and everyone who's listened to this debate, and even people who want to lift the hand sword will see it. But William, it's not 50-50. It's not 50-50. So I'm going to disagree with you there, but you'll disagree from the day and hour we looked at each other, so there's nothing new. apart from anything else, the fact that we're looking at an alternative and the fact that that alternative went to consultation, I'm heartened. I haven't seen it yet. I heard the Minister outline at least 5 or 6 outcomes, what he likes, what he wants to see in it. That's a good thing. But I think we're going to add to it. We do need to talk about the intimidation, and everybody's talked about it. Jenny outlined some of the aspects what's happened in her constituency. CNRs, it's actually referred to as a by the bullet scheme. So let's call for what it is. And for anyone to claim that we're just doing away with intimidation points, I believe is misleading, and it's unfair. There are people who are intimidated. There are asylum seekers who are intimidated. There's refugees who are intimidated. There are women and men intimidated through domestic violence at home. There are lots of reasons why people are genuinely intimidated. But we've all said the system's being abused and people are taking the hand. And what happens when that system is abused, the genuine people who have the humiliation of living on sofas and in hostels with their wee kids huddled up, waiting for years to see somebody jump in the queue, I don't think anybody could stand over that. So I would like to see, I haven't heard anybody saying anything different. We've all give examples, we've all heard examples, and they all sound so familiar to us. We've asked questions about land availability to build houses. We need to build houses. We need to build houses, and we need to build them where there's need. And we also need to try and develop and support communities. I, along many other people, have written to different departments to try and find land availability. And it's up to each of us to try and get that sorted out. And I, like Fra and many others, have seen successive ministers making promises with the best of intentions, and they can't be kept for all different reasons. But I think we're in a different place, because the acute housing problem, if it's not addressed either through affordable housing, availability of land in order to build, what we actually are doing is watching the slow privatisation of housing, because the private rented sector, while some of it's great, and I'm not a landlord, but the private rented sector is becoming the alternative to social housing provision. Now, there is a need for the private rented sector, but not as the alternative. The alternative for us isn't working. That's not working either. And there are some very good landlords out there as well. So the challenge for us is to look at the replacement of the scheme. I'm delighted that that replacement is going to come forward for public consultation. We do, and we have said, that when people are claiming to be intimidated or alleging intimidation, it does need to be verified. So you can't be intimidated. You can't ask somebody to intimidate you in a pub on a Sunday. Walk around the corner, get your so-called threat on Monday, and have your points allocated the next Monday after that. That's ridiculous. But that's what happens. And when that happens, the humiliation of the families and the hostels continues. So I defy anyone who's going to stand over that system. I would defy anyone, because it ain't working. Now, there was a need for a third-party scenario to exist years ago. That's gone. If people get their cars broken into, they can go to the PSNI. If the PSNI, along with a charity or an independent, can verify it, then so be it. But the days of which people are claiming intimidation through schemes or through pals or whatever, it needs to end. Because our constituents are living for years on end in misery. And I don't know anybody who could stand over that record. So I'm delighted we've received cross-party support for this motion. I commend Fra for bringing it forward, and I look forward to the consultation into the revised housing selection scheme.
Thank you. Order. Question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye. Aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Item 5 on the order paper, the adjournment. The question is that the Assembly do now adjourn. The Assembly is adjourned.